Dentro de poco en la colección popular publicaremos Johnny el Tuerto, una novela histórica que muestra un amplio abanico de lo que fue la Guerra de Independencia de los Estados Unidos. Johnny el Tuerto, a pesar de tener un solo ojo, es el único que puede ver estas circunstancias, las circunstancias de la guerra tan caótica desde una doble visión. Pues es un espía doble, ¿no? Entonces, a través de su mirada, vamos a ver a George Washington, a Alexander Hamilton, a Benedict Arnold y otros muchos personajes que nos va a cambiar un poco la visión de la historia. Traducida por primera vez al español por Irving Roffle, esta novela desmitifica personajes históricos y nos va a cambiar el panorama. También publicaremos de Jerome Sharing, el mismo autor de Johnny el Tuerto, Pana María, que se centra en un castillo oscuro y lúgubre que está en el corazón de Nueva York y que está ahí Stefan Weil, ¿no? Que es hijo del zar, de inmigrantes polacos y que como muchos otros extranjeros en el siglo XX, pues iban en busca del sueño americano, pero en un contexto de prostitución y crimen. Entonces, Jerome Sharing es escritor, crítico, autor de centenar de novelas, guiones cinematográficos, compilaciones de cuentos, ganador de premio como el Rosenthal Award, y nos da muchísimo gusto a Paco Taibo y a mí tenerlo aquí con nosotros para hacer una entrevista. Hi, Jerome. It's really nice to have you here.
I love that kind of approach to history and approach to the structure of the United States. It's supposed that you go into the Polish minority to talk about other minorities because it's a country of minorities. There's no majority in the construction of New York, no?
My father was from Poland, and I thought it would be more interesting than a Russian. You know, we have Dostoevsky, you have too much Russian. I thought the Polish minority, and there was a Polish minority in the United, and these are non-Jews. That's not, you know, and I thought that it would be an interesting, you know, it all happens in a big whorehouse. And I thought it would be a good way, you know, Stefan Weil goes to Ellis Island and he tries to lure women into Panna Maria. So I thought that would be a good way of getting into a slice of American history that is very unfamiliar, you know.
But at the same time, it's the story of the Irish and the police control.
Oh, yes, yes, of course, of course. It's a story of corruption, of the, you know, wherever we go, wherever we see, wherever we look, there always is a kind of crazy corruption between the police and the procurers, the prostitutes. And so this was one way of not trying to totally politicize it, but to make it into a novel where you could feel for the characters. Because the you cannot write, you know yourself, Paco, you cannot write a novel that is not political. There's politics in every sentence. There's politics in every word. You know that yourself.
Yeah.
So, I wanted to write, and you know, there was a comic book that Munoz did on Panna Maria. I don't know if you ever saw it. It's wonderful. In black and white, and there's a crazy story, because when I got my copies, the first page was missing. The page on Ellis Island was missing. So they had to redo the whole edition. You know, is completely, the world of publishing, as you know, is not sane.
Your style, your way, the way you understand literature is so different to everything you usually read about the United States. First is this idea that they crossed this island, the immigrants, and one generation after, the kind of immigrants change, no? And there they are, the non-existent Negroes, American, Afro-Americans, the Jewish community, the WASP, Anglo-Saxons, and Dutch, that believe that the country is their own. They are the owners of the country. the Polish, the Russians, the Gypsies.
Yeah.
O sea, anytime you touch the United States, you find something different to tell a new story, no?
And unfortunately, as far as the blacks are concerned, they were until very recently invisible in the culture. They weren't written about in the culture, and this is a great sadness about the United States. We fought the Civil War, and many historians say the Civil War is still being fought today, and I agree with it. The Civil War never ended. It began, and we had one great American. We have two great Americans. We have Abraham Lincoln, and we have Malcolm X, and those are the two great poets of the United States. And they're very different, and yet very similar. They both were very poor. Malcolm X was a pimp, known as Detroit Red. But his transformation into a kind of poet, not only for his people, but for all people, like when he said, "We didn't land on Plymouth Rock, Plymouth Rock landed on us," you know. So I like to think of those two. I mean, Abraham Lincoln in his time was a kind of racist, but he evolved and he changed and he understood, and he is the greatest of all Americans, you know, in my opinion. It's a tragedy that he died when he did.
Talking about the United States, I want to ask you, why did you do a character like Johnny One Eye?
Well, first of all, the idea of one eye that he could only see, and the fact that he's George Washington's illegitimate son, you know, is sort of taking a slap at the whole mythology of the United States, to think of George Washington's bastard son. But I always begin a novel, I always begin a novel with one idea, with one scene in my mind, and that was George Washington's interrogation of Johnny One Eye, who's really a double agent. You know, he's a spy for everyone. We're all double agents, you know. So that's the way the novel began, and then it moved, you know, like a strange flower. It grows larger and larger, and finally, you know, the flower grows too big, and you have to end the novel at some point, because otherwise it could go on forever. It could be the story of your life. It's Borges who said that a writer writes his or her entire life only to discover that he or she is only doing a portrait of his or her own face. So everything you do, no matter how far it goes, is really about yourself. You are really imposing yourself upon the world, and it's your own mythomania that you construct or reconstruct history. I have no idea what the revolution or the Constitution was really about. This is just my version of the way history, though I did a great deal of research, you know, about New York and all the prostitutes in New York. I don't know, the one thing that ties Johnny One Eye and Panna Maria is they both sort of exist in a house of prostitution. And you think of the word prostitute, you think of these women, they should have one great union, you know, to protect their rights. But throughout history, prostitutes have really, you know, been, I would love to see a history of the world told through the eyes of a prostitute. You know, it would be very interesting, very powerful, and very poetic.
When you start a novel by your own chatting, you never know what's going to happen.
You shouldn't know what happens, Paco. You know that.
No. I'm always surprised by the way you approach to subjects. War cry over Avenue C.
Yeah, that's a crazy
madness.
It's madness.
Madness.
It's true. It's madness. War cries over Avenue C. You have to remember, I grew up during World War II. So in a way, my life began and my life ended. My life began with the beginning of the war and ended with the end of the war. You know, I'm left the tin drum, Goss's tin drum, with the little boy who doesn't grow after the war is over. I'm that boy. I'm Pinocchio, you know.
Blue Eyes. You changed the way mystery is being written in the United States. The Isaac Seidel Quartet, starts with Blue Eyes. You changed the way that mystery was written in the United States. Yeah. You introduce magic, surrealistic approaches, everyday's life at the same time, all kind of levels of corruption, crime in New York. Then you go to Metropolis.
Yeah.
Then you go to comic books. Then, yeah. What always surprised me is that you never know what's going to happen with your own charting book.
But
you know when it starts.
No, Paco, that's the whole point. It's a puzzle. It's a labyrinth. If you go back to Alice in Wonderland, you know, what does a word mean? A word is anything the way you want to use it. And this is the way I see language. You know, language doesn't own me. I own, you know, the words are out there, but I can use them any way I want, and I can progress or move into a scene or out of a scene any way that makes sense for me. And it's my own crazy head. You know, I grew up crazy. I am crazier now. And this is why, you know, I continue to write, because otherwise you would just fall asleep. You know, if you had one formula for a novel, you would just do them again and again, you know. But look, what happens? What's the dilemma of Blue Eyes? You have a hero, Manfred Cohn. And what other novelist would kill him in the middle of the novel? It's crazy, no? It's completely
crazy. It's great.
Yeah, okay, so what do I do? I have to bring him back alive. Am I gonna do it magically? So I just go back into the past and do a prequel, you know, where he's still alive. So it's the same thing like Tarantino in Pulp Fiction. In one scene, you have a character dies, two scenes later he comes back. Why not? You know?
Why not?
So
I'm always amazed talking with you.
We've always had the good talks because you, of all people, understand my craziness, and also you see it as a virtue rather than, you know, you see that the unexpected is really where we have to go, is that you have to close your eyes and follow the text. And for most, for you, it's not a problem, but for many people, it is a problem, you know.
When I open the book, the most important thing for me is the unexpected, the surprise. Because see, if you already know what's going to happen in that book and how it's going to happen, the magic is lost.
It's not that I'm consciously doing it. It's just that at some point, I was writing Blue Eyes, and I said, okay, he's in a ping pong match, and now he has to die. Okay, I still have to continue the book, but you'll have to continue the book without him. I'm sorry, you know. So that was the fun. Well, maybe it's like playing a crazy chess game, you know, where if I were Bobby Fischer times five, I would make the unexpected move. And this is, I was teaching someone how to play chess, and I took the black pieces, and instead of playing defensively, I played offensively. And he didn't know what to do, because black, when you take the black pieces, you're supposed to defend. I attacked, you know. So So this is the way I write. It's always an attack. If you look at the novels, Paco, it's always a kind of attack, a movement forward, you know.
No, estamos seguros que nuestros lectoras y lectores van a disfrutar muchísimo las novelas próximas de Jerome Sharin. Johnny el Tuerto va a ser la primera que saquemos, pues nunca ha sido traducida al español. Y después tendremos también en los siguientes meses Pana María.